I don't think they even forgot. Most of them don't even know about it. If I travel over to Great Britain and they ask me, where am I from? I'm from Enniskillen. They never heard tell of it. And where is Enniskillen? It's in Fermanagh. Where's Fermanagh? So they don't really know. We're only 2.7% of the population, and it never came into their minds. It's not that they forgot. It just wasn't in their mind and their psyche in the first place.
Nobody realised this was even going to be a problem. We probably knew it would be, but English people didn't. And I think if they had the same vote today, it would be rejected, you know. Just, I think this whole Irish problem they didn't see coming, you know.
It's essentially the border for Irish people. It's border infrastructure, it's freedom of movement, it's hard borders, bad old days, peace process.
Todo se reduce a la frontera cuando se trata del Brexit en Irlanda del Norte. Es la parte más pequeña de las cuatro que componen el Reino Unido. No llega al 3% de la población. Y es, con Gales, la más pobre. Y es aquí, en este rincón, donde ha encallado el Brexit en el último tramo. Porque aquí estará la única frontera terrestre entre la Unión Europea y el Reino Unido cuando éste abandone el club. Y es una frontera extremadamente delicada. Tan invisible hoy como históricamente trágica. En este viaje recorreremos los 500 kilómetros de esta frontera, con sus más de 200 cruces, que son sus divisiones invisibles, y las visibles, los muros vecinales y mentales. Irlanda logró la independencia del gobierno británico con una guerra y una condición, la partición de la isla. Londres cedió poder a cambio de que los 6 condados de mayoría protestante, leales a la corona británica, siguieran bajo su soberanía. Eso partió en 2 el Ulster y la isla de Irlanda. Los católicos rechazan esa división como definitiva y se resisten a llamar a la parte británica por su nombre oficial, Irlanda del Norte, porque eso supone aceptar la partición.
When you call this the Irish border, this is wrong. This is a British border put on the island of Ireland against our choice, our will. And this border has lasted for nearly 100 years, and during this 100 years this border has marked itself like a scar on our brains, formed a kind of damage in our minds. And even when this border is gone, and I hope it will soon be gone forever, it will leave a scar. And that scar will remain for many, many years.
Darling, you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go? If you say that you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time.
El Reino Unido votó mayoritariamente abandonar la Unión Europea. Should I stay or should I go? Un 51,9% frente a un 48,1%. En Irlanda del Norte, en cambio, ganó seguir en la Unión Europea, un 55,8% frente a un 44,2%, con una división: apego mayoritario a Europa en los condados fronterizos y entre católicos, rechazo en los de mayoría protestante. Visitaremos la circunscripción con más partidarios de la Unión Europea y el otro extremo, los más opuestos.
The only thing that you realize is, on crossing the border here is the signs between the kilometers and the miles per hour. Kilometers been in the south and the miles been in the north. So we're just approaching the border here again.
Estamos en el llamado pólipo de Dramoli. Lo de pólipo viene por la forma que tiene esta porción de la República de Irlanda que se adentra en Irlanda del Norte. El trazado de la frontera es tan sinuoso que la carretera principal la cruza 4 veces en 9 kilómetros.
This house is in the south here, this first house, and the second house here. The half of that second house is in the north. That first one being in the south, and the half of that house there is in the north. So we are back now, basically north and south here at the minute.
Eamon Fitzpatrick suministra combustible a varias granjas de la zona, a ambos lados. Vivió lo que llaman frontera dura, con controles, y no quiere que vuelva.
We have a farm of land down the road here, and it is only about. It's only about 2 miles from here down to it. When the border was here before, we had to go about 10 miles to get to that farm. So we had to go 8 miles of a diversion to get to it. So like, that's inconvenience, so it is, and it's a cost and it's everything else along with it.
Hace 20 años, cuando los acuerdos de paz, decidió abrir una de sus gasolineras tienda en unos terrenos que tiene en plena frontera.
So you have half of you.
Half of me is
Brit.
I'm a divided man. I can still operate.
So, which means that you have half your business
in the north.
So, what do you have in the UK?
Well, we would have like the shop. All that building over there is all in the UK, as such.
Okay, so, and then so.
All the remainder of the business here is in the south.
Los surtidores de gasolina están en la República de Irlanda. La caja para pagar y la tienda. En el Reino Unido. Manejar dos monedas, euros y libras esterlinas, no es el problema. Es algo común en zonas fronterizas. Los problemas, si el Reino Unido sale del mercado único y la unión aduanera, serían otros.
We would buy a lot of stuff in from England, we buy a lot of stuff out of other countries, and the biggest problem with them is if there comes tariffs, so that they are where you go from, you know, where you go from there. That's your biggest, you know, your biggest issue. There's going to have to be a transition period, I think, because it can't be, you know, the more than the deadline supposed to be the 29th of March or whatever, well, the next day they can't be physically possible with borders or whatever, so it's going to, I don't know what the transition period will be, but it's going to have to be a while, and I'll take that. For argument's sake, you hear the bit.
Y sin preguntar, irrumpe en la conversación el gran miedo que acarrea la mención de controles entre el norte británico de Irlanda y el sur independiente, la violencia.
So, like, if you have a hard border and you have, let it be your customs is out there stopping, like somebody's not going to stop some night and they're going to drive through them. So maybe that happens a night or two, then the next thing the army's took in. But then the next night, that they drive through them and the army's there, maybe the army might fire on them. So it's going to leave the window open for trouble somewhere along the line.
I suppose worst of all would be the troubles coming back along the border, like what we had in back in the 70s. Because anywhere there's a borderline, I can't see different generations has rebelled against it.
Los problemas, los troubles. Es el eufemismo con que se refieren a tres décadas de enfrentamientos armados entre protestantes que quieren seguir en el Reino Unido y católicos que lo rechazan y persiguen la unificación de la isla. Tres décadas de los años 60 a los 90 que dejaron más de 3.000 muertos. El gobierno británico militarizó entonces la frontera. Tom Conlon, con 80 años, es memoria viva de la Irlanda independiente. La frontera invisible cruza sus tierras y las parte en dos. En aquellos años se convirtieron en campo de batalla.
That main road that used to come down there, there would be different checkpoints. There could be official, as we would call them, official checkpoints. We'd guard the checkpoints in the southern side, British Army and the UDR in the northern side. And then you could have unofficial checkpoints, which would be either IRA or UDA.
Era habitual que el ejército británico entrara en estos campos sin avisar. La fórmula para sobrevivir era la ley del silencio.
If you lived in an area like this and you were farming along the border, you seen nothing or heard nothing. You went about your business and you done your daily work and seen to your cattle and your family, because you see, people maybe doesn't realize that. If you're living along a border where there is trouble, well, if you see anything, let it be army or the people who are attacking the army, you're going to see nothing. Because if you do, you'll not be there to tell it the next time.
Los sábados toma rienda para Mercadillo una parcela que tiene en el norte rodeada por la frontera. Si en la futura relación entre el Reino Unido y la Unión Europea vuelven los aranceles, todos dan por hecho que volverá el contrabando, actividad tradicional en esta frontera extensa y porosa.
At the end of the war, there was no tea much in the south, so you could get tea in the north. Then there was no sugar in the north, and people smuggled sugar across into the north, and there were different things like that. And then at a later time, then butter was subsidized in Northern Ireland and Great Britain, and it was very cheap, so it could go south. And then there was all sorts of things. In the north, you had white flour for making bread, and it went south, and there was all this little bit of to and fro. Britain went out of the common market, there'd be tariffs on the goods and stuff, and that would, and machinery would be the same.
Tom tiene la casa en la República de Irlanda y ganado en los dos países. Con la salida del Reino Unido de la Unión Europea, agricultores y ganaderos temen por sus terrenos en el norte.
If the homes are split and it's Brexit comes in, the northern side may not have any a single farm payment unless that Britain gives it, you know. Yeah. So that's why the farming is in danger.
After crossing out of Belcoo in Northern Ireland into Black Lion, Southern Ireland, and now we're going to go back out here into the north again. And this is the route I have to take to get to my local post office, my local agricultural goods outlets, for diesel, for petrol, anything like that there, any goods. I got across into the south and then go back into the north, and the same thing to get back to my home.
John Sheridan es un ganadero importante de Irlanda del Norte y un activista del lobby Comunidades Fronterizas contra el Brexit.
Well, we have lobbied in Dublin, we have lobbied in Westminster, we have lobbied in Brussels, Strasbourg, and we've lobbied in the United States.
A pocos kilómetros de las tierras de Sheridan, en Enniskillen, encontramos voces minoritarias en la frontera, a favor de salir de la Unión Europea.
I voted leave primarily because I believe that there's too much power concentrated now in Brussels and Strasbourg. I didn't vote leave because I'm anti-European, far from it. I believe in those core principles of cooperation, especially for peace within the European countries, for mutual prosperity within the European countries, and I'm still fully behind that.
Don't mention Brexit to me particularly, because it threatens our past, it threatens our present, and it surely threatens our future. And I don't see any opportunities that the Brexiteers talk about.
But I believe that even in the short term, if there is difficulties through Brexit and there's some upheaval and some difficulties caused because of it, I still believe that in the longer term, it'll prove more beneficial to be outside of the European system than in it. And I would still hope, remain optimistic that Brexit could happen and we could still have a good trading relationship and a good working relationship with the rest of Europe.
James Johnston dirige el mercado semanal de ganado y volvería a votar Brexit, pero no quiere una frontera entre el Reino Unido y la Unión Europea dentro de Irlanda. Sus deseos y los de la mayoría topan con la realidad.
I knew that that was always going to be a potential consequence as part of my decision. I was always confident and optimistic that the border wouldn't be affected.
Keep right to High Street.
Seguimos nuestro viaje y llegamos a Pettigo. Una parada casi obligatoria si hablamos de la frontera.
So you can see the difference in the road if you look down. You see the difference in the tower?
Slightly.
A small difference, yeah. So, one leg on each side now. This is the border here. So this is Southern Ireland and this is Northern Ireland. These are all my customers, but they are going to have to come this way over the bridge, and then there may be people stopping here to say, where's your passport? And like the people might say, I'm just going for a cup of tea to the cafe.
Pettigo, el pueblo partido por la frontera río. En un lado pudieron votar en el referéndum sobre la Unión Europea, en el otro no, son sujetos pasivos del divorcio. En cada extremo del puente los carteles son sintomáticos. Bienvenidos a Irlanda del Norte en la parte británica. Bienvenidos a un condado distinto en el lado irlandés. En el sur reconocen el cambio de condado, no de país.
This is the old customs hut where you used to have to stop. So this is where all the custom men used to work from, in this door here. And so they used to stop all the traffic here.
Pettigo tiene unos 400 habitantes y un centro cultural y polideportivo inaugurado en 2014. Es uno de los proyectos financiados por la Unión Europea para fomentar la relación entre católicos y protestantes. Está en la República de Irlanda, pero la mayoría de sus usuarios son de Irlanda del Norte, del Reino Unido.
It has done a lot of genuine cross-border reconciling the communities. So we wouldn't have any issues or any problems here. And I suppose, obviously, going forward and for future generations, that is the important key. And we can't be returning to hard borders and hence troubles.
Do you fear that it could come back?
Most definitely, yes.
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 La salida del Reino Unido de la Unión Europea puede tener consecuencias no previstas para británicos y para ciudadanos de la Unión Europea. De eso hablan estas tres amigas en el condado de Donegal, en la República de Irlanda. Lizzie Doherty se recupera de un cáncer de mama y está preocupada.
Not only thinking of myself, but my brother also availed for prostate cancer. He even lives closer to Derry. He's only maybe 10 minutes from Derry. And I think, imagine, were we so lucky that we were able to go to Derry. Please God, they won't take it away from people that need it. They really, really need it. Out here in the Republic.
Lizzie, ferviente católica, ruega para que después del Brexit se mantenga el acuerdo entre los gobiernos irlandés y británico para que los pacientes de Donegal reciban radioterapia en Derry, Londonderry. Cruzando la frontera invisible, Lizzie tiene el hospital a apenas media hora en coche. Ahora acude solo para las revisiones. De no haber existido este acuerdo sanitario, las sesiones de radioterapia habrían sido mucho más complicadas, porque la unidad más cercana en la República está muy lejos.
As you can see, the 8 centers of excellence are Galway, Dublin, Lyme. So nothing up here. So really, who in government departments, be it the EU, be it anywhere, gives a monkey about the people in Donegal and the healthcare needs of the people? If you're in Donegal, do you travel or die? If we're talking about the radiotherapy. But there's an important one. We have no railway. We have no motorway. There's no other county in Ireland that has this situation.
The worry was that I was going to have to leave home, stay away for 5 days, travel a very long journey for about 5 hours, and I would have to stay there for the week, come back on a Friday night and travel back, and by the time you're ready to go again, you were just about rested and you would have to go again.
In the context of Brexit, there's also a very important one that needs to be mentioned and included. For the young children in the 6 counties of Northern Ireland, they access their paediatric cardiology services at the hospital in Dublin. So we're asking, you know, in the context of the children, who's worrying about them? Will that cross-border service continue as well? You know, so
there's... El gobierno británico y el irlandés aseguran que los acuerdos sanitarios se mantendrán, pero ni la paciente ni la activista se fían.
No, I don't trust the politicians to tell us all the details. We would get some details of it, but I would like to see it.
Health needs to be the number one priority. Then they can talk about the economy, then they can talk about agriculture, they can talk about everything. Health should be number one.
Lizzie, when you went for this...
I'm sorry, I'm just passionate.
No ha sido el único domingo sangriento en la sangrienta historia de Irlanda, pero sí el más reciente. 30 de enero de 1972. Fue en el barrio católico más emblemático de Derry o Londonderry, el Boxside. Empezó como una manifestación por los derechos civiles y acabó en una matanza. ...14 personas muertas por disparos del ejército británico. Costó 38 años que una investigación oficial llegara a la conclusión de que no hubo provocación previa a los disparos del ejército. Cuando el informe se hizo público, el primer ministro británico, que tenía 6 años cuando ocurrió la matanza, pidió perdón en el Parlamento.
What happened on Bloody Sunday was both unjustified and unjustifiable. It was wrong. The government is ultimately responsible for the conduct of the armed forces, and for that, on behalf of the government, indeed on behalf of our country, I am deeply sorry.
We'd had an apology from David Cameron, which an apology means absolutely nothing if you've lost somebody by murder.
Kate Nash solo tiene una foto de su hermano William. Aquella tarde de enero le dispararon al pecho. Tenía 19 años e iba desarmado.
Do you think that justice has been made?
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not. The people who perpetrated that crime have never been brought to trial. We've never had due process. The law has been denied to us for 47 years.
Poco después de hacer la entrevista, la Fiscalía anunció el primer juicio a uno de los militares del Domingo Sangriento, un soldado cuya identidad no se ha hecho pública.
A decision has been taken to prosecute one former soldier, Soldier F, for the murder of James Ray and for the murder of William McKinney. Charges will also be brought for the attempted murder of Joseph Friel, Michael Quinn, Joe Mahon, and Patrick O'Donnell.
I was going to say good morning, everyone, but I don't think it is. We have had a terrible disappointment in the outcome from a PPS of this series of charges.
Que 47 años después se vaya a juzgar solo a un soldado no les parece suficiente. Todos los años, en cada aniversario, siguen reclamando justicia. Este año hemos sido testigos de su petición, que encausen también a uno de los oficiales al mando. Encabezaban la marcha familiares de los muertos y figuras históricas del movimiento católico. Martin McGuinness era hijo de este barrio, el Bogside. Fue un mando del IRA y luego hizo un viaje extraordinario de las armas a la política. McGuinness fue uno de los artífices de los acuerdos de paz entre católicos y protestantes que se firmaron el Viernes Santo de 1998, hace 21 años. Ejerció como segundo del gobierno autonómico y llegó a estrechar la mano de la reina. Un apretón de manos como pocos que ilustra el camino recorrido en estos 20 años. Y sin embargo,
are you glad for these last 20 years for the Good Friday Agreement?
I don't know. I don't even know if I've ever trusted it. You know, I don't think I've ever trusted it. You know, it's because there's never been what I would describe as real peace.
We drive now here to this house, right? Okay. And I'll show you where the big, and you can actually, if you get out of the car, you can see the monument to the 5 British soldiers that was killed and to the guy that was forced to drive the bomb into. Yeah, those ones there.
El profesor Eamon O'Ciarda es de los muchos que viven en el lado de la República y trabajan en el Británico. Nos conduce al cruce de Koshkin, uno de los puestos fronterizos militarizados contra los que atentó el IRA.
Everything around here would have been devastated.
Fue en 1990. El IRA obligó a llevar la bomba a un civil que trabajaba para el ejército británico. Murieron 5 militares y el civil. Casi todos los norirlandeses tienen motivos para no olvidar y para no querer volver a aquellos tiempos.
The Republic of Ireland, under Articles 2 and 3 of its constitution, claimed suzerainty over the six counties of Northern Ireland. They gave up that claim as part of the negotiations for the Good Friday or Belfast Agreement. And what was a central clause in that agreement was that there would never be a hard border on the island of Ireland.
Volvemos a Derry, Londonderry, la ciudad de los dos nombres. Derry para los católicos, Londonderry para los protestantes. Es donde más votaron a favor de la Unión Europea, un 78,3%. Es un feudo católico y una ciudad segregada. Estremece ver el católico Bogside a tiro de cañón y entrar por este túnel en el enclave protestante de Fountain. En Irlanda del Norte hay un centenar de muros entre barrios católicos y barrios protestantes. La mitad construidos después del alto el fuego por voluntad de los vecinos. La desconfianza tarda más en borrarse que las instalaciones fronterizas. Las dos ciudades son caras contrapuestas de la Nueva Irlanda. Belfast es el escaparate reluciente de la transformación, de las grandes inversiones. Derry, no. Y sus ciudadanos lo consideran una nueva forma de discriminación contra los católicos. Nos alejamos de la frontera para ir al otro extremo político, Ballymena, feudo del unionismo protestante más radical. De aquí era Ian Paisley, el sacerdote protestante que desde posiciones diametralmente contrarias hizo un camino a la paz similar al de McGuinness. Ballymena sigue siendo la plaza fuerte de su partido, el DUP.
I can clearly remember walking down the street in Ballymena and seeing signs in the windows of at least three shops saying situations vacant. Catholics need not apply.
Aquí el Brexit logró el porcentaje más alto de Irlanda del Norte, 62,7%. Un voto que se explica por la afiliación política, pero también por el perfil socioeconómico, parecido al de algunas zonas del noreste de Inglaterra. Un área industrial venida a menos. El año pasado cerraron la multinacional japonesa JTI con casi 900 trabajadores y la francesa Michelin, que tenía 840. Ha sido un golpe duro para los trabajadores y para la ciudad.
I voted to leave. I don't particularly like the way the European Union's headed. And if I'm totally honest, I think Michelin Ballymena closed as a direct result of European policy or intransigence, whatever way you want to put it. We lost, Michelin lost 1.1 million truck tire sales to Chinese imports. Now the Chinese imports have massive subsidies on them. The Chinese government subsidizes the raw materials, they subsidize energy, labor's very cheap, but the European Union's so keen to trade with China that they impose no tariffs on it.
I voted to stay in the European Union. I thought that was the best option. You know?
I voted to leave.
Why?
First of all, I thought the country was going the wrong way. I'm not racist. But I still thought there was a lot of things that our government should be doing for us. What they're doing for more immigrants, no, foreigners coming in and out. So my job at the minute is nearly 90% foreign nationalists. And we have to keep them in the country to keep us going. Full stop.
Most of them from the European Union or from other countries?
Poland, Romania, all them countries, Bulgarians, all lovely people too. Mm. All doing a good day's work.
Como John, la mayoría achacan a la inmigración el deterioro en sus trabajos.
The only way you could ever make local people do those jobs is to either increase wages or make the jobs better.
Terminamos nuestro recorrido en Belfast, la capital. En Irlanda del Norte, una sociedad torturada por las divisiones, hemos encontrado un doble consenso: la sensación de abandono y el rechazo a una frontera física interna. Pero sin frontera, si el Reino Unido sale del mercado único y la unión aduanera, ¿cómo controlará la Unión Europea lo que entre en Irlanda y, por lo tanto, en los 27? La falta de acuerdo en la respuesta ha llevado al retraso de la salida. Se ha sugerido, por ejemplo, una frontera electrónica.
It's feasible to have control without physical control. No, it's not feasible to have control without physical control.
How do you check a lorry with 100 sheep on it or a cattle trailer with 25 cows on it, each of them that has an ear tag and, you know, they have three different tags in their ear, you know, they have... How do you actually physically check each of them? You know, I think it's impossible.
Otra alternativa es establecer los controles en puertos como el de Belfast, es decir, colocar la frontera entre Gran Bretaña y la isla de Irlanda, algo a lo que se opone el DUP con el argumento de que eso rompería la unidad del Reino Unido.
Northern Ireland is different than the rest of the UK. We have different laws on abortions, on same-sex marriage. We have different rules on planning permissions. We have our own government.
El Brexit en Irlanda del Norte trasciende las cuestiones técnicas. Se vive con angustia existencial.
It's going to ask people to you know, examine their identity if... By virtue of the fact that they have a British passport, this may prevent them from studying in Vienna or studying in Heidelberg or Florence or Barcelona. So, you know, politics, culture, identity is important, but they are often trumped by hard, you know, bread and butter issues. And I think that the border, this issue presently is a bread and butter issue more than it's a... It's a political issue. As our sun begins to
fade. I mean, we're a huge economy. Permanent members of the European Security Council. The UK will survive outside the European Union. How? We don't know. But after all this is over, there's talk of tax harmonisation laws on corporation tax across Europe. If that happens, the Republic of Ireland is absolutely screwed. Taught me what to say
in school. Call me a European. I'm delighted and all of us happy to be a European. I'm still a European at heart. And no one's ever going to take that away from me. No Brexit's ever going to take that away from me.
El Brexit es otro reto que llega a la isla de Irlanda desde Gran Bretaña. En este rincón del Reino Unido no querían y no quieren salir del club europeo. Es un reto para el futuro al que tienen que hacer frente cuando el presente aún es frágil y el pasado demasiado cercano y traumático.